Hello everyone. My name is Pastor Vincent Lawal of Transformation Sanctuary International. And it's a privilege and a honor to be on this platform with His Fellowship to bring the Word of God to you this evening. And I have a short message, a short admonition, which I want to share with you tonight, which I've titled, Fight for Your Home. Fight for your home. Fight for your home. And my key text will be taken from Acts chapter 8, verse 3 to 5. Acts chapter 8, verse 3 to 5. You see, we live in an age and time when there's a lot going on in families. Families are splitting. People are going separate ways. Children are raised fatherless, not because the father is dead, but because he's not part of the arrangement. People are living under all kinds of conditions, which is not God's ideal for us. And we're going to look at a scriptural reference today, which will help us shed more light on that. But even looking at it from a societal perspective, you find that when two people work together as one to raise a family, such children are usually healthier, such children have better self-esteem, such couples have longevity, such couples have a happier life, a healthier life. So it pays when we pull together and we fight for our homes. And there's a devil out there who doesn't want our home to succeed. He's doing everything in his power. And it doesn't matter what situation, where you are on your spiritual journey. Maybe you're listening to me tonight and you've got nothing to do with faith. You just live your life, you do your own thing, and you've just come across this video and you're listening to it. Or maybe you are a new Christian, you're a new believer, you've just started your journey of faith and all that, but you've got a family, or you're a child in a family, or maybe you're an experienced Christian, you're an advanced believer, you're a pastor, you're a prophet, you're already serving God, you're in the ministry, or maybe we're even lucky tonight, maybe we have the Pope or the Archbishop listening to this message tonight. The truth of the matter is, we all have to fight for our homes if we're going to gain the blessings of marriage. We've got to fight for our homes if we're going to raise godly children. We've got to fight for our homes if we're going to have the economic benefits of synergy, partnership, pulling resources together to raise the kind of family we want and the kind of life we want to see. Let's go into scripture now. Acts chapter 8, verse 3 to 5. Acts 8, verse 3 to 5. It says, then the scribes and Pharisees brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, verse 4, they said to him, teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses, in the law, commanded us that such should be stoned. But what say you? Now, contextually, of course, you had the scribes and the Pharisees whose role, whose life ambition was to discredit Jesus, putting Jesus to the test and trying to see what he would say. That's one of the key lessons here. The wisdom God gives us to answer questions when men are trying to trip us. But that's not what I'm looking at tonight. I am looking at the woman who was caught in adultery. So at this time, it was the Feast of Shelters, the Feast of Tabernacles. It was a feast the Jews organized to remember the time when they were in the wilderness. There are three main feasts the Jews celebrate every year, three key ones. There are many other little ones, but there are three key feasts the Jews celebrate every year. There's the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, or Passover. There's the Feast of Trumpets, or Pentecost. And there's the Feast of Tabernacles. Of course, this was the Feast of Tabernacles. And what happens is, at that time, tents had raised in fields in and around Jerusalem, where people live for 7 days to celebrate the time when they were in the wilderness. It's a joyful time. You can imagine children looking forward to it. You know, they're intense. They're not at home. It's like when you go camping. But this one on a national scale, everybody living in tents, eating together, doing things together. People coming from all the nation together to Jerusalem to worship the Lord. Beautiful, isn't it? I pray the Lord will help the church today to get to that point of synergy where we're able to pull together and do things together. But Feast of Tabernacles going on, a time of celebration, a time of joy. But also it's a time when people with ulterior motives do things. So at such times, you find that stealing is rife because it's so easy. You can dip in into 10, steal things, run away. You find out things like sleeping around is rife at that time because, again, people are intense and all of that. So in my understanding of Scripture, when this woman was caught in adultery at this feast, there's a strong possibility that she was in one of these tents. And that was why it was so easy to catch her at what she was doing. She was caught in the very act, as they said to Jesus. And they took her and dragged her. Imagine the public shame. Imagine the national shame. Everyone who had come for the feast could see a woman being dragged away to her death. They were going to stone her because that was what the law of Moses said. And I assume at this time that they had torn her clothes. I assume at this time that she was just holding on to the little she had left to cover her shame. She saw death staring at her in the face. People were already picking up stones. You can imagine as they were dragging her, a young man said, oh, there's a good stone here, there's a good stone. Why is he picking up the stone? Because he's going to stone her. He's going to kill her. And people were picking up stones. And this woman was going to her death. And you can just imagine the thoughts that were going on in her mind at this time. Why did I do it? Why did I get involved? Why did I allow that man to talk me into sleeping with him in a tent or wherever it happened? Why? And all that. And prior to that, I imagine, you know, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 9, verse 17 to 18, it says, stolen waters is sweet, and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. But he does not know that the dead are there, and her guests are in the depths of hell. So when this woman was going to commit this act, it was like, oh, shush, 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 shush. You know, the secrecy that comes that makes sin so pleasurable. The secrecy that comes with sin that makes it so pleasant. But what she did not reckon with was that she was going to be caught in the very act. And I don't know who I'm speaking to today. Maybe you're involved in some kind of sin and things like that, and you're doing it, and you think, oh, I've gotten away with it. I'm going to do it again. I've gotten away with it the second time. I'm going to do it again. The Lord is telling you, please desist from that sin, because it's not going to take you anywhere. You only need to be caught once, and you're done. You're finished. So it's better you repent today and allow God walk through you and give you a better future than the one you're trying to steal. So back to the story of this woman. As she was going, she was thinking about that. She looked into the crowd. She saw friends. She saw her parents. She saw her brother. She saw her sister. Maybe she saw the man's wife. She saw people around her. And she was looking at them like, this is the last time I'm going to see these people, as they took her along. But as they walked along, they looked to their side and they saw Jesus teaching in the temple. And they were like, oh, you know what? We can get two for the price of one. We've always wanted to bring down this man from Nazareth. Let's use this woman as a scapegoat. So they took the woman to Jesus and said to Jesus, we caught her in the very act and we're going to stone her because that's what Moses says. But what say you? And I'm sure for those of you who read your Bible and who know your Bible, you know the end of the story. Jesus did not condemn the woman because he could see in and through her. He knew her situation. The woman wasn't a prostitute. The woman had a home. But something had gone wrong in her home that had led her to go out and commit adultery. That was what Jesus saw. He did not see the act. He saw the motive. He condemned the sin, but not the woman. And that's what we want to look at. That's what we're looking at this evening. Why do people commit adultery? Why do people leave their homes to go sleep around? Why do people engage in extramarital relationships? I'll give you a few pointers tonight as we build up on this. Some people will go out there because of anger or revenge. My partner did it and asked for forgiveness. Now, yes, I've forgiven them, but it's not balanced. Because their marriage is on a transactional basis. You do, I do. You don't do, I don't do. Such people, in looking to get back at the partner, revenge, hit them, make them feel the pain they have felt, will look out and commit adultery. But you know, two wrongs don't make a right. And going out and doing something like that just causes more problems and eventually destroys the marriage. Some in seeking revenge might be because one of them is never there. Maybe the woman is high flying and she's always traveling. She's always everywhere. And the man is just there and it's like, I'm just here alone. And maybe he has a house girl in places where they have house girls or peers and all that. And then he sleeps around. Or maybe the woman has been hearing, oh, her husband has been sleeping about and all of that. And in getting back at him, she does the same. Anger or revenge is the reason why people commit adultery. Another one is no longer loving the person. Maybe when it all started, it was all arranged anyway. It wasn't really genuine from the start. There was ulterior motive for whatever reason or whatever they were at the start. You know, when it started, he promised life. He promised money. He promised wealth. He promised bliss. And all of that is not happening. And at the end of the day, one of them looks at the relationship and they're like, you know what, this is not working for us. They go outside, they commit adultery, extramarital affairs. That's another reason. Another one is situational factors or opportunities. There are many people who didn't set out, who didn't wake up on the morning and like, I'm going to go out today and have extramarital affairs or commit adultery. But being in the wrong place, moving with the wrong type of friends, moving, you know, I was in church this morning and I said to them, I said, you eventually become the sum of the people who are closest to you. You eventually become, as a person, the Bible says, iron sharpens iron. So does a man sharpen the countenance of his friend. Somebody said, you are an average of the five people who are closest to you. So if the five people who are closest to you are people who don't have regard for their families, people who sleep around, people who are always in the pub, always in the bar, drinking, and all that, people who place little or no value on the family home, on the marital life, you find out that it's just a matter of time before you begin to imbibe such attitudes. So you've seen people who just went to the pub and because they got drunk, they went and slept with somebody else and that destroyed their marriage. They didn't plan it, it just happened and all of that. So situational factors and opportunity, a workplace romance, you know, somebody at work, I call them jump players, people who they give you the listening ear. You know, they appreciate you. They tell you how good you look, how nice you talk, and all of that. All the emotional needs you are not getting at home, that is not being fed at home. They feed you somewhere else. And what you don't know is what they're doing to you, they've done it to 1,000 people before you. And you're just the next victim. You're just the next sacrifice. And they do that. So, situational factors, you know, commitment issues. You find some people who are like, I can't stay with one person. I'm just one person all my days. No, that's not going to work. The way they see their partner is almost like the way they see their phone. After using it 2-3 years, you know, you've got to upgrade. And you know, there's a craze in our society. Oh, there's a new iPhone 13 out now. We must get it. And all that. Ridiculous, you know. But some people see their relationships like that too. something they need to, oh, you know what, I need to upgrade, I need something else. That's another reason why people go into extramarital affairs, unmet needs, unfulfilled sexual desires in the marriage, wanting variety, low self-esteem. You know, you look at yourself like a man. Oh wow, your hair is turning white now, and all that. The six-pack is gone, and all that. And you're not really doing well financially, and you are in a midlife crisis, and you're trying to re-engineer, reinvent yourself. And what do? You try to look for somebody young, and you look into another relationship and all of that. Searching for meaning, searching for life, searching for purpose in the wrong place. That's what happens again. That's another reason why people commit adultery. And like I said, friends who do the same, working with people who don't care, who are always, and they tell you, look, everyone does it and all that. Why not? That's the nature of society today. That's why people commit all of this. And this woman who was caught in the act must have fallen into one of these categories when she did what she did. And if that woman had only fought for her home, if that woman had only said, no, I am going to fight for what God has given me. Marriage is of God. God created marriage. Three institutions God gave man: the church, the government, the civil government, and marriage. Those are the three institutions God gave to humanity: the church, the government, the civil government, and the home, the marital life. If this woman had fought for her home, like, no, I'm not going to allow the devil creeping into my home. I'm not going to listen to naysayers. People will always tell you, you know what? My statistics shows anyway that 70% of couples divorce before their 25th anniversary. 40% divorce before their 7th anniversary. When you begin to listen to such things, it leads you down. It leads you down the wrong road. This woman, if only she had fought for her home, then there would have been change. Then there would have been, she would have saved her marriage, and she wouldn't have found herself in a situation where standing before the whole nation, scantily clad, waiting for people who were going to stone her to death. And if not for Jesus, and thank God for Jesus, if not for Jesus, that woman would have been dead. But thank God for Jesus who saved her. And the same Jesus who saved her is still able to save us today, you know? And there are a few things, so in fighting for our homes, there are a few things we need to bear in mind, a few things we need to do as we begin to tidy this up. Number one, we must, in fighting for our homes, we must pray for our homes. I counsel couples every time, and I see how so little prayer is given to the marital home. Prayer for your husband. Prayer for your wife. Prayer together. The Bible says two are better than one, for they get more reward for their labor. Here is the man. He's the minister. He's a preacher. He's a world preacher. He's trying to save the world. He's praying for the world, but he's not praying for his own home. Here is a woman. She's in a relationship and she desires something better. And she's praying for her children. She's praying for her sick mother. She's praying for her brother who needs a better job. But she can't find it in herself to pray for her own husband. Oh, because he's a stupid man. Oh, he doesn't know what he's doing. Oh, he needs this. Until he changes, I'm not going to change. And more importantly, praying together. There is no force on earth that can stand between a couple who pray together. The Bible says, where two of you are agreed on anything on earth, it shall be done by my Father who is in heaven. Marriage is a business of agreement, and it is spiritual. So if you are in fighting for your home, number one, instead of fighting that woman who's chasing your husband, his PA at work, his secretary, that person, that man who always smiles slyly at your wife when you go to church on Sunday, instead of fighting those people, fight on your knees. Pray together. Form synergy. From my personal experience, every day, my wife and I pray together. And one of the reasons for that is we learned very early that when we don't pray together, we argue. Very, very easily. Toothpaste becomes a problem. Dinner becomes an issue. Who's driving the car becomes a problem. And I always say, when your prayer level is low, your problem level rises. But when your prayer level is high, your problem level is low. So in fighting for our homes, we must learn to pray together. That's number one. Number two, we need to seek for peace and harmony and work at it in our homes. Seek for peace and harmony. If you continue to argue with your spouse, a sage once told me, he said, nobody gives you an award for winning an argument in your own home. Nobody comes to you and like, oh, well done. Yes, you are right. She is wrong. Which is where a lot of times, which is what we're fighting about, isn't it? Oh, I'm right. I'm right. I'm always right and all of that. And it destroys. You win the argument, but you lose the war. We must seek peace and harmony and work at it. We cannot sow the seeds of anger and bitterness and expect things to work. Maybe you've started praying already as a woman. Lord, touch my husband, touch him, change his life. But then he comes home, he asks for dinner, and you're like, go to the kitchen, you know, cook yourself. Who knows where you're coming from anyway? Meanwhile, you just finished 2 hours prayer. You are walking against what you are praying about. Seek for peace, seek for harmony. Don't turn everything into an argument. I always say to people, if we only live our lives at home the way we do at work, a lot of us will have a peaceful life. Some of us, our managers at work say things to us. Oh, can you please get that thing done? I need it by 5 p.m. And you're like, yes, Lucy. Now that in your mind, you're like, I was planning to leave at 3 p.m. You know, and now this woman has brought this thing. But you don't say to them, how dare you? Who are you? You can't control me. You can't tell me what to do. And all that. Even if you are the head and the neck, you know. You don't say that to your boss at work. But we feel we have the right to say that in our homes, in our houses, even as husbands too. If we live a life, the way we collaborate at work, people come together, people tell you things that are different from what you are thinking. And you're like, yes, that's a good idea. That's a brilliant idea. We need to take some of that and add it to what we're thinking. You don't rubbish the idea. And yet here is your partner, here is your wife telling you, why not do it this way? You know what? A white shirt would have suited you better. And like, what do you know? What are you talking about? What do you know about dressing? Oh, go completely, come on. You know, if we only live our lives at home the way we do at work, a lot of our marriages will be better. Let's sow seeds of peace and harmony and work at it in our homes. Number three, stop infighting for your home. Stop listening to people who have had failed marriages. And that might include your mother. Stop listening to them. Stop listening to people who always tell you, you know what? Oh, so you guys are in love. Very, very new, you know? You're the first. I was like that 20 years ago, you know? And he left me and he went with somebody else. Those people, those kind of words, those kind of thoughts will not help your relationship. Look at people, look at role models who are doing well. Look at people who have been 20 years, 30 years, 40 years in their relationship, and they still love each other. The Bible says Isaac got to the land of Gerar, the land of the Philistines, with Isaac, with Rebekah, his wife. They got there, and like father, like son, he said to Rebekah, you know what? You are beautiful, and those people are likely to have plans for you. Please say I'm your brother. I don't want to die, please. And Rebecca was like, I thought you were my husband. You're meant to fight for me and stand for me. I said, look, my life is at stake here. Say you are my brother. And she said, okay, fine. And the king welcomed them and gave them accommodation because it's a very beautiful woman and all of that. But to God be the glory. Thank God for men who love their wives. Thank God for men who still sport with their wives. Thank God for men who will sit down and laugh and play and push their wives and do things together. Thank God for men whose relationship in their home is not just a project. Have the children eaten? Have we paid our bills? Am I going to work? And all of that. Thank God for men. Hey, Bible says Isaac played with Rebecca, probably danced with her, was laughing at her, probably pushed her. And the king, who was watching from his window, saw them and was like, brothers and sisters, don't do like this to each other. So he called them. He said, why did you lie to me? She is not your sister. She is your wife. And Isaac said, hands up, that is true. That's the kind of relationship we need to build. We need to sow into our relationship. Look at role models. Look at what they do and do it also. Take time off. Spend a weekend together away from the home. There are women, I'm not just going to say women, there are spouses who once the children are born, they forget the other partner and they just focus on the children. That is very, very wrong. That child will one day leave the home and both of you will be left. And if you don't sow into your marriage today, there'll be nothing in future to reap. You know, life is about investments. What we sow today, we reap in future. That is what life is all about. And that is what we need to bear in mind. So that's number three. I'll give you two more and I'll round up for today. Number four, we need to seek help and advice before it is too late. Many patch up their relationship. Many stay in there until they get to the point of no return. And then they go their separate ways, or they begin to seek help when it is too late. That's not the way it should be. Seek help early. Marriages have challenges. Marriages have problems. Seek help. Cry out. Go to experienced people. We are not agreeing on this matter. Help us. And let them give you advice so you can save your marriage rather than leave it till too late. And finally, let us avoid circumstances or people who make us prone to extramarital relationships. If you've got friends at work who are not married and are sleeping around, find better friends. If you've got people around you, if your mother is always telling you how her own marriage failed, stop listening to her. Listen to her and everything else, but discount that advice. Listen to people who are making it work. Don't allow people take you to a point where things will not work. It pays to fight for our homes. The Bible says how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell together in unity. When we dwell together in unity, God releases his blessings, even life forevermore. So God's presence comes into our home when we dwell in unity. We're able to raise godly children when we dwell in unity. We're able to pull resources together and build a good and better future for ourselves. A future not dependent on miracles, but rather a future built on blessings. The blessing of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Blessings you can leave to your children. That is what God wants us to do, and that is my charge to you tonight. And right now we're going to pray. And like I said, maybe you have not even started this journey of faith and your home is in disarray, or maybe you're not married yet and you're looking for the Lord to give you a home that is worth living for, a home filled with peace and happiness. Or maybe you are a man of God like me, and in your situation, your home is in disarray because you focus so much on the ministry that your home has suffered. Your children are wayward and all that. We can pray together today and the Lord will touch you and the Lord will bring about change to your life. I'm going to make an altar call now. First, for those who want to commit their lives to Jesus and allow Jesus come into your home and change your story. And afterwards, I'll pray for fellow Christians just like me who are struggling in your marriage. Because when we work together, when we pray together in synergy, we are able to defeat the enemy. The Bible says one will chase 1,000 and two will put 10,000 to flight. Please join me as we pray. And as you are there, if you're not giving your life to Christ, or you are rededicating your life to Christ this evening, maybe you've gone astray and you want to come back to the Lord, please pray this prayer after me. Please say with me, say, Lord Jesus, I thank you for today. I thank you because you are my creator. I thank you because you came to the earth to die for me. I thank you because if I was the only person on earth, you would still have died for me. I acknowledge my sins today. I ask that you forgive me, Lord. I ask that you come into my heart and be my Lord and Savior. That from today, my life will begin to reflect you and your glory. I accept you as my Lord and Savior today. I am born again. I thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord, I thank you for all those who have prayed that prayer genuinely. I thank you for coming into their hearts. I thank you for changing their story. I pray, Lord, may they begin this new walk with you and may their lives be transformed from glory to glory. May they see change. They're citizens of heaven now. May they live in the supernatural. May they have come to taste the Lord. May they see indeed that the Lord is good. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And I pray for everyone who has listened to this message today, who are struggling in their relationship, who are struggling in their marriage. I pray, Lord, I join my faith with them. And I pray peace upon the storm. I speak peace upon the storm. I command the waves to die down. In the mighty name of Jesus. Visit their home and heal them, O Lord. Bring about a turnaround. And may your name be glorified. We love you, Lord. We exalt your name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for sharing your time with me this evening. And as you go and take that bold step to fight for what is yours, your home, your marriage, to fight for success in your home, the Lord will help you. And you will have testimonies in the name of Jesus. I'm Pastor Vincent Lawal of Transformation Sanctuary International. And it's a privilege and a honor once again to come here and minister on the platform of His fellowship. God bless you.